हेलो, आई एम वेदांत। आई एम अ लीगल इंटर्न विथ लेक्सिस एंड कंपनी। इन यस्टरडेज वीडियो वी हैव डिस्कस्ड व्हाट आर द कॉन्सिक्वेंशियल डैमेजेस, व्हाट सेक्शन 73 ऑफ द इंडियन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एक्ट सेज अबाउट दैट, एंड डिस्कस्ड अ वेरी फेमस इंग्लिश केस ऑफ हेडले वर्सेज बैक्सटेन। वी हैव ब्रीफली डिस्कस्ड द फैक्ट्स एंड व्हाट वॉज हेल्ड बाय द कोर्ट, एंड बट इन दिस वीडियो वी विल फर्दर डिस्कस अपॉन द इशू विच वॉज रेज बाई डिफेंडेंट इन अपील एंड वॉट कोर्ट ऑब्जर्व फर्दर। सो द इशू रेज बाई द डिफेंडेंट इन द अपील वॉज वेदर द डिफेंडेंट इन ब्रीच ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट कुड ऑल्सो बी हेल्ड लाइबल फॉर द डैमेजेस दैट द डिफेंडेंट वॉज नॉट अवेयर एंड विच वॉज सफर्ड बाई द प्लेंटिव फ्रॉम द ब्रीच ऑफ द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट। सो द कोर्ट ऑब्जर्व दैट वेन टू पार्टीज हैव मेड अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट विच वन ऑफ देम हैज ब्रोकन, द डैमेजेस विच द अदर पार्टी ऑट टू रिसीव इन रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ सच ब्रीफ ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट should be such as may fairly and reasonably be considered either arising naturally, that is according to the usual course of things from such breach of contract itself, or such as may reasonably be supposed to have been in the contemplation of both parties at the time they made the contract as the probable result of the breach of it. Now, if the special circumstances under which the contract was actually made were communicated by the plaintiff to the defendant and thus known to both the parties, the important word is known to both the parties, the damages resulting from the breach of such contract which they would reasonably contemplate would be the amount of injury which would have ordinarily followed from the breach of contract under those special circumstances as known and communicated. But on the other hand, if the special circumstances were wholly known to the party breaking the contract, he at the most could only be supposed to have had in his contemplation the amount of injury which would have arisen generally and in the great multitude of cases not affected by any special circumstances from such breach of contract. The court further pointed out that how do these circumstances show reasonably that the profits of the mill must be stopped by an unreasonable delay in the delivery of the broken crankshaft by the carrier to the third person. Suppose the plaintiff had another shaft in their possession put up or putting up at the same time, and that they had only wished to send back the broken shaft to the engineer who made it. It is clear that this would be quite consistent with the above circumstances, and yet the unreasonable delay in the delivery would have no effect upon the intermediate profits of the mill. Or again, suppose that at the time of the delivery of the carrier, the machinery of the mill had been in other respect defective, then also the same result would follow. Here it is true that the shaft was actually sent back to serve as a model for the new one, and that the want of a new one was the only cause of the stoppage of the mill, and that the loss of profit really arose from not sending down the new shaft in proper time, and that this arose from the delay in delivering the broken shaft one to serve as a model. But it is obvious that in the great multitude of cases of miller sending a broken shaft to third persons by carrier under ordinary circumstances, such consequences would not in all probability have occurred, and this special circumstances have never communicated by the plaintiff to the defendants. Therefore, applying the aforesaid rule and considering the facts and the special circumstances which were was communicated by the party to the defendant, it was held that the plaintiff could not recover the loss of profits from the defendant. A similar question arose in the case of Victoria Laundry versus Newman Industries Limited. In the said case, the defendant were to deliver a boiler for a plaintiff and the delivery was delayed by 5 months. As a result of not having enough laundry capacity, the plaintiff lost a high value cleaning contract from the Ministry of Supply. The plaintiff sued the defendant for the loss of profit on account first, the large number of customers which could have been served if the boiler was delivered on time, and second, the amount the plaintiff could have earned if it had received the contract from the Ministry of Supply. In the instant case, the defendant were aware that the plaintiff required the boiler for immediate use, and therefore it was held that the defendant as a reasonable man could have foreseen some loss of profit, though not the loss of profit resulting from the special circumstances with respect to Ministry of Supply's contract. Therefore, defendant was held liable to compensate for the ordinary loss of profit and not for the extraordinary loss of profit, which were on the account of special circumstances. Analyzing the principle laid out in the aforesaid cases, it is evident that there are two categories of damages which can be claimed by the non-defaulting party. First, which can be fairly and reasonably considered arising naturally, that is, in the usual course of things from such breach of contract itself. And second, which may reasonably be supposed to have been in the contemplation of both the parties at the time they made the contract as the probable result of the breach of it. The first category refers to the direct damages and the second category refers to the consequential damages. Consequential damages can only be claimed by the non-defaulting party in case the special circumstances resulting in the consequential damages were already brought into the defaulting party's knowledge at the time of executing the contract. It is also relevant to highlight that Section 73 of the Act clearly provides that compensation is not to be given for any remote or indirect loss of damage sustained by reason of the breach of the contract. However, it also states that the non-defaulting party is entitled to receive from the defaulting party the compensation for any loss or damage caused thereby, which the party knew when they made the contract to be likely be a result of such breach. It is also evident from the discussion that the principle laid down in the case of Hedley versus Baxendale have been adopted within the language of Section 73 of the Indian Act, and the same has also been applied in various Indian cases. Thank you.